your host, Dr. Brenda Green, and we are coming to you from the studios of Meg Rivers College over the airways of WMYE 91.5 FM. Writers on Writing comes to you each week and gives you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers talk about their work, their craft, and their lives. I'm very, very pleased to have on the phone with me this evening an award-winning writer, teacher, lecturer, scholar, Marita Golden. Marita Golden, welcome, Marita.
Thank you, Brenda. I'm glad to be here.
Okay. Marita Golden is the author of more than 16 works of fiction and nonfiction. Her most recent novel is The Wide Circumference of Love, which I just learned has been nominated for the NAACP Image Award. So congratulations on that.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm in very good company in my category.
Yes, you are. Yes, yes. So as I said, Marita Golden is an author of over 16 works of fiction and nonfiction. She's also a teacher of writing. She's a lecturer, has lectured on women's studies and literature, African-American studies. She's a literary activist, founder of the Zora Neale Hurston Richard Wright Foundation, which presents the nation's only National Fiction Award for college writers, and a summer workshop, as well as the Hurston Wright Legacy Award for published writers. She has won a number of awards over her life, and the NAACP Image Award is just one of those awards. So it's really, really good to have you again with us. We honored Marita Golden at our National Black Writers Conference. So let's begin with The Wide Circumference of Love, which is a wonderful story. I'd read it in just a couple of sittings. Tell us about The Wide Circumference of Love, just a general summary, and why it was important for you to write this story.
The Wide Circumference of Love is a novel that opens on the day that Diane Tate, a family court judge in Washington, D.C., takes her husband, Gregory, who's a successful architect, to live in a memory care unit because he's been diagnosed with early-onset Alzheimer's. The novel is the story of what happens to their marriage, what happens to their definitions of love and commitment as they journey through Alzheimer's. It's also the story of their grown children and their relationship to this new development. But it's mostly, I like to think of it mostly as a love story set against the backdrop of Alzheimer's.
Yes, it's a very, very moving story, and so many of us have people in our families who've had Alzheimer's. So many of us have had to cope with it. I had my students write about write a response to seeing you talk about it, and the responses were just so moving, and they were just so heartened that you were motivated to tell that story, and you were honest about why you told it, and the amount of research that you've done. And that's, a lot of your books are based on really a wide range of research. But just going back to the story, what would you say to people who are coping with their loved ones who come up with this illness? What do they need to do?
Well, I think it's very important to first to acknowledge what's happening. Very often people in the family will see a family member acting in ways that are very, very unusual, that go beyond just forgetting things. And very often the family will be in a state of denial. Also, the person who has Alzheimer's will be in a state of denial about what's happening to them, which is understandable. But it's very important for family members to acknowledge that something may be seriously wrong with their loved one, and to support their loved one in the journey to acknowledging it themselves. It's very often common to get resistance from the person who has dementia or Alzheimer's. But I think family members need to consult their doctors, consult social workers, counselors about the best way to get their loved one who they suspect is suffering from dementia or Alzheimer's into a doctor, into a neurologist for a PET scan. So I think the first thing is really facing what's happening. And it's really important to do that because the impact of Alzheimer's is so sort of global. It's economic, it's social, it's psychological. It places an enormous burden on the family, and families, frankly, need time to be able to adjust to the new reality and marshal all their financial, emotional, spiritual resources to support their loved one.
Okay, and how did you go about doing the research for this? You came to that. What was the research process like? And again, why was it important to tell a story like this right now?
Well, I don't have anyone in my family who has Alzheimer's or dementia. And I was actually inspired to write this story. I was not interested in Alzheimer's at all. In fact, I was working on another novel and kind of hit a wall with that book, put it aside for a while. And then some of the characters in that book assumed a new life in this story. So that it's not so much that I chose this story, but I do think that this story chose me. And I really do think that very often in the creative process, whether it's writing or film or dance or music, when you're taking on a creative project, often that project will claim you. And that's kind of what happened here. So I had to do a lot of research. It involved reading other novels and nonfiction memoirs about Alzheimer's. It involved researching what the disease actually was or is, as well as spending quite a lot of time in a memory care unit in my area, where I spent time simply being around people who have the disease. And then I also talked to family members, wives and grown children, who were supporting their parent or their spouse as they dealt with and lived with and sometimes died of the disease. So it was a lot of research. And then when I was doing my research, I discovered the statistic that African Americans are twice as likely to develop Alzheimer's as whites. And that was actually very stunning to me, because the public face of Alzheimer's, as we see it in the media, is mostly white. But the more I researched this aspect, I found that the fastest growing population that's developing Alzheimer's and dementia are African Americans, and after that group, Latinos. So that I then, after I finished the novel, proposed to the Washington Post to do an article on specifically African Americans and Alzheimer's disease. So I spent another year talking to advocates and researchers.
Okay, and I imagine that was one of the highlights of doing this book. What were some of the other highlights that happened as you were doing this book? Because you said it's basically, you called it, it's also a love story. So what were some of the high points?
Well, I think a continuing high point in this very difficult realm was to hear stories from family members and spouses and siblings about how, even as their loved ones were declining because of Alzheimer's disease, they nonetheless managed to connect with them in a very, very deep and meaningful way around maintaining family bonds and love and commitment. So so that even though people with Alzheimer's are cognitively diminished, they remain very sensitive, very intelligent, they're very present, and very often they're stripped of some of the neuroses or issues or problems that may have erected barriers between them and other people, so that many people shared stories of finding a new kind of vulnerability and emotional accessibility in the person with Alzheimer's, because they've kind of been stripped to their emotional core. And so I had not expected to hear that, but I heard it often enough that I came to realize that the disease is often an opportunity for families who can marshal what it takes to find a new dimension of love.
You know, as I listen to you talk and I think about all of the books that you've written, and you talk about how sometimes books find you, they call to you. Your writing life has really been based on a calling where you start from that perspective in your life as a journalist, I imagine, where you look at issues in our society and then you choose to select or to create fiction and or nonfiction to tell that story and to highlight it for us.
I mean, I'm a serious writer. I'm not sort of drawn to lightweight, to write about lightweight subjects. I'm always interested in subjects that are going to sort of shake me to my core, subjects that I often don't know anything about that will require me to do an enormous amount of research and that have the capacity to change me and hopefully in what I create, change the reader.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about some of those other books where you've been called to do that? You know, I'm thinking the books that really made an impression on me. Of course, your first was Migrations of the Heart, because I related that to that growing up in the 60s, but also raising black, your book
Saving Our Sons.
Saving Our Sons. That was something, having two sons. I really connected with that. Can you share with the audience some of those other books that you've written as a result of having this need to say something that really hits you to the core?
The need to say something. Yeah, because I mean, I think that what writing, I write fiction in order to give expression to my imagination, and that's a powerful thing, to basically sort of create a situation, a family out of thin air. That is, the families in my novels exist on paper, but I create them hopefully with enough vividness that while you're reading the book, you actually think they're real. And that's really a wonderful thing to be able to be called to do. It takes a lot of hard work, but you do it because you like to do it, because it's hard and you don't know how to do it, so you try to figure out how to do it. The nonfiction serves another purpose in that it allows me to kind of talk back to the culture, to kind of get into public discourse, and as an African-American, to provide what I feel is a more dimensional and complete rendition of what our lives really are like. And, for example, when I wrote the book Don't Play in the Sun, One Woman's Journey Through the Color Complex, that was a book that, in a way, I'd been sort of writing all my life, because as a brown-skinned woman, I'd been the victim of colorism. It was rampant in my family. It's a global belief, the belief that lighter-skinned people, no matter where they are in the world, are always more beautiful and more valuable. So it was very Satisfying for me to be able to do that book. And I just came, I had not, that book also, I didn't choose to write that book. My stepdaughter called me up one day and she said, oh, there's a video on BET that I know you'll love. And it was a video that Indy Ari had done about her song called Video, about not being a girl who looks like the girls in the video. And I saw how that song resonated for so many people in the community. I mean, mothers were playing it for their daughters. People felt really empowered by that. And actually, she empowered me to then think about writing about the subject. So then I did, and it was really transformative because I not only write about colorism as it affects darker-skinned people, but even lighter-skinned people. Everybody, in some way or other, is a victim of colorism, and many of us are perpetrators of it.
That's right.
So it was very satisfying to write a book that gave voice to what many people have been feeling, and also that found a way to talk about it in a way that was healing.
Yes, and a lot of your stories end up going toward that path. Like, how do we have this trauma in our lives? We have this political or social situation in our life, and how do we survive it? How do we cope? You also did that in After. You want to share what you did in After?
Yeah, well, that was a story about a African-American police officer who kills a young man during a police stop. He thinks the young man has a gun, but it turns out that it's a cell phone that he's holding, and he shoots him because of that mistake. And it's a psychological study of the aftermath of that lethal and tragic mistake for the police officer as well as for his family. And that's a book that's also a lot about coming to terms with the past and forgiving. I had to talk to a dozen or more police officers and go out with them on their job, and I learned a lot about the problems in policing, how police officers are so often poorly trained, there are no universal nationwide standards. And then I also met and talked with many very professional police officers who had never once fired a weapon and who took their job really seriously and didn't feel that their job was to just, you know, be a, you know, a John Wayne type character. So it was very satisfying to write that book as well.
Right. So that ends up, those kinds of issues, I think, end up helping to place some of your books in our curriculum in college writing classrooms and I imagine even in high schools. That's something that we would like to see. You celebrate and acknowledge writers through founding the Hurston Wright Foundation. Would you talk a little bit about that and what's going on with that? I know that you're no longer the head of it, but you're a foot.
I'm emeritus, yeah.
Yes.
27 years ago, I co-founded the Hurston Wright, the Zora Neale Hurston Richard Wright Foundation with Clyde McIlvaine. And I had been doing literary and cultural activism for a while and wanted to start an organization that would be national in scope. So actually, it was founded right at a time when there was a sort of a second, what people were calling kind of the second renaissance of black writers in the early 90s. And the organization actually started with an award for college writers and then grew into the first multi-genre summer workshop for black writers and then evolved into an organization that presents the Hurston Wright Legacy Award each year, which honors African-American and African-American writers from the Caribbean, America, everywhere, for their literature as well as honoring cultural icons. So in the past 27 years, we've had an enormous impact and creating new opportunities for Black writers and honoring them, providing mentorship and training and community. And I'm very pleased that as we're moving into the 28th year, a new generation of leadership and leaders have taken over the organization. It was very important for me to groom that leadership and to step away so that they could lead, and they're doing some great things. We just honored Haki Madhubuti and Carla Hayden and Congressman John Lewis at the Legacy Awards in October. And many of the Black college writers who win the Herzerite Award go on to publish with quite acclaim.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. We've had many of them at our conferences. So what are you working on now? What's your next project? Because you're always in flux, always working.
Well, I'm I'm currently working on an anthology. The whole issue of Alzheimer's has become really important to me. I think it's really important that in our community, because we're so deeply impacted by it, that we raise awareness. And so I'm working on a number of projects to raise awareness about the impact of Alzheimer's in the African American community. And one of those is an anthology where I've asked some writers to write pieces about, I'm calling it Love in a Silent Storm, about the impact of caring for, loving, living with someone who has Alzheimer's and maintaining family bonds.
Okay, and we cannot leave out what you're doing as a workshop leader, as a teacher, and how you're also motivating young people to write. What messages can you give to writers about how they proceed, and what is your style? You've talked a little bit about the importance of research, but what is your what can you say about your craft and your writing process?
Well, every time I started a new project, I'm starting anew, and that project doesn't know that I've written 16 books. I have to prove myself. So I have to learn how to write that particular project. And I write one word at a time, one sentence at a time. And it's a process that I take with a great deal of seriousness and a lot of love and commitment. So I think that young writers, I kind of get disheartened when I meet writers who, say, "Oh, I wrote this book in a week," or "I wrote this book in six months," or something, you know, and they've written a book that they have, but they haven't become a writer. And I think that that's fine if you just want to write something and publish it. But I'm most interested in working with people who really do want to become writers. And that's kind of a lifetime commitment, and there's an enormous amount of joy in it. It's hard work, but it's a very satisfying way to live in the world. So I suggest to young writers that they be humble, that they read a lot, that they take workshops, that they be in community with other writers, and that if they have a story to tell that is kind of scary or that frightens them, that's a good thing, because that means that it's a powerful story, and they shouldn't shrink from the story. They should dive into it, even if they have to dive in at one toe at a time.
Well, that's a wonderful message, and I want to encourage our listening audience to go out and purchase The Y Circumference of Love, to order it, to continue to watch out for Marita Golden. Visit your website.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the website's Marita Golden, M-A-R-I-T-A Golden, @gmail.com. I'm giving my email, maritagolden.com, and you can contact me through my email. And I'll actually be offering, starting in January, a series of monthly writing seminars. I think it's the second Saturday each month, but I'll be offering them at my home. So if there's anyone listening who lives in the Washington area, D.C., Maryland, Virginia, they might want to get information about that, and they can contact me through my website.
Right. And Marita Golden is someone who will respond to you almost immediately when you contact her on her website. So I strongly encourage people to follow up and to keep in touch with Marita. Visit her website. There's always a lot of information about workshops. You can keep up with what's going on with her writing life and with other work that is coming up. So thank you once again, Marita, for taking the time to talk to us. And you've been listening to Writers on Writing. I want to thank my producer, Fritz Richardson.
And thank you, Brenda. I enjoyed it.
Okay. You're welcome. And remember, the writer is always reading. The reader is always writing. Keep reading and writing. Empower yourselves as readers and writers. This is your host, Brenda Green, signing off.
Song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes.